Okay. Dear friends and colleagues, good evening. Let's start. Welcome to the second lecture of the series of lecture. Timothy Williamson talks his own philosophy, organized by School of Philosophy of Wuhan University. Tonight, Professor Williamson will talk about his first book, Identity and Discrimination. Identity is a very important and also very difficult topic. Huayin has a famous slogan, no entity without identity. Why? Because first, the identity is the standard to distinguish different objects apart. For example, the computer in front of me and I myself are different objects because we have different identity. Also, identity is the standard to identify the different stages or different occurrence of same object as the same object. For example, Tembo as a chair, Tembo as a youth, Tembo as a middle-aged man, Tembo as an old guy. We say this is the same Tembo because there is a personal identity between these occurrence. So the identity is very important topic and also very difficult to clarify. Now, let us to listen to Professor, Professor Williamson will say about this topics. Tonight, his interlocutor is Professor Liu Xiaofei from School of Philosophy of Wuhan University. Now, we welcome Professor Williamson to start his talk. Okay, welcome.
Thank you very much. First, I need to share my screen. Good. Well, thank you very much. What I'm going to be talking about are things related to my first book, which is called Identity and Discrimination, which was first published in 1990. But its origin actually goes back to about 1974, when I was a first year undergraduate student at Oxford. I was interested at that time in the theory of logical constructions, which was associated with Bertrand Russell, Rudolf Carnap, especially in the Aufbau, Nelson Goodman in his book The Structure of Appearance, A.J. Eyre, who's a professor at Oxford that I was talking about last time, and others. So logical constructions in the sense of attempts to to show how we could at least simulate the objects that we talk about in ordinary language by some kind of logical constructions out of sense experience. So an approach, roughly speaking, associated with logical empiricism, but a little bit more general than that. I mean, Bertrand Russell wasn't 100% an empiricist. So here's one particular logical empiricist idea, which I think is connected to what all those philosophers that I've mentioned were interested in. So this is to do with the nature of perceived qualities, for example, colors as we see them, or as a particular observer sees them, and perceived shapes. And so we're talking about, as I say, qualities just as we perceive them. So something not so much external qualities out there in the world, but rather the qualities as they figure in our experience. That was the kind of logical empiricist idea about these qualities. And so one consequence of this idea is that where we or the observer cannot perceive a difference in quality, the perceived qualities are actually identical. It's the very same quality. And where we can perceive a difference in quality, the perceived qualities are distinct. So in other words, on this view, when we're talking about the identity or distinctness of perceived qualities, that depends on the capacities of the observer who's supposed to be perceiving these qualities. So in that sense, they may be different. The same object may have different perceived qualities for different observers, and maybe even different perceived qualities for the same observer at different times. And so an example of this would be that the perceived color of X is identical with the perceived color of Y. The double arrow just means if and only if X is visually indiscriminable in color from Y, roughly speaking, where the observer cannot see any difference between X and Y in color. So the point of this is not to individuate perceived colors by something objective like the wavelength of light or anything like that, but by the way in which they're actually experienced by the observer, and what differences are perceptible to the observer. So, I mean, a kind of philosophical terminology for this, which used to be very common. It's not, I mean, was certainly very common in the 1970s when I was thinking about this problem first, maybe not so common these days, is that to say that indiscriminability in color on this view is a criterion of identity for perceived colors. It's the standard by which their identity or non-identity is determined. And as I've mentioned, that perceived colors in this sense, they're relative to the observer's perceptual powers and the conditions of observation. So they're not the same for all observers and all times. Now, that seems at first sight quite a natural way of setting a standard for the identity of perceived colours in terms of the observer's capacity to distinguish a difference. But Bertrand Russell and others noticed a logical problem for perceptual indiscriminability as a criterion of identity for perceived colours. So I'm going to explain what this logical problem is. The identification of this problem goes back well over 100 years. So it's been known about for quite a long time. So the first thing to emphasize is that identity is a transitive relation. So if A is identical to B and B is identical to C, then A is identical to C. And this, I mean, the transitivity that can be proved from more basic logical features of identity. So I'm taking it that it should not be controversial that identity is transitive in that sense. Just as a particular application of the transitivity of identity, we have that if the perceived quality, remember the quality here could be a perceived color or a perceived shape, it doesn't matter what, but here I'm just going to do it abstractly in terms of qualities. The perceived quality of X, if the perceived quality of X is identical to the perceived quality of Y, and the perceived quality of Y is identical to the perceived quality of Z, then the perceived quality of X is identical to the perceived quality of Z. And that's just an application of the transitivity of identity, this very basic logical feature. And so one thing that follows from that is that if indiscriminability to the observer, if that's a criterion of identity for perceived qualities, then indiscriminability must also be a transitive relation because they're equivalent. The equivalence is what's meant by it being a criterion of identity. And so if they're equivalent and one of, and then they must either both be transitive or neither is transitive. And so what that implies is that if X is indiscriminable from Y in the relevant respect, of course, like color or shape, if X is indiscriminable from Y and Y is indiscriminable from Z, then X is indiscriminable from Z. So that's just a consequence of indiscriminability being a criterion of identity for perceived qualities. But the trouble is that indiscriminability is not a transitive relation. So something's gone wrong with this approach. This is a problem that Russell and others identified. And so let's just consider an example to make it clear why indiscriminability is not generally a transitive relation. So let's consider this the following example. So we've got a sequence of color samples, C0, C1, C2, up to CN. I mean, think of it as a very long sequence, maybe, you know, with 100 color samples or 1,000. And imagine that C0 is clearly yellow and so not red, and CN is clearly red and so not yellow. So they're very clear cases. But when we look at any two samples in the sequence that are next to each other, so we've got CK and CK plus one somewhere in the sequence, that they're so similar in color to each other, as it were, objectively speaking, that CK is visually indiscriminable in color from CK plus one. for the relevant observer in the relevant circumstances. So if you look, if you take any two neighboring, you know, color samples in a sequence, ones that are next to each other, the observer can't tell the difference between them in color. They can't see that there is any difference in color because they're so close. And so if visual indiscriminability in color is transitive, then C0 is visually indiscriminable in color from CN, right? Because we have a link between C0 and CN. There's a kind of chain of indiscriminability between them, a long chain. But transitivity implies that, you know, if there's a long chain of things related by the relation we're interested in, then the first member and the last member are also related by that relation. That's just a logical consequence of applying transitivity over and over again. So since each neighboring pair is visually indiscriminable in color, and on this assumption that that visual indiscriminability in color is transitive, we get that the first member of the sequence is visually indiscriminable in color from the last member of the sequence. But of course, that's not right, because C0 is visually discriminable in color from CN. One of them is, the first is clearly yellow, the second is clearly red. And so the observer has no difficulty in seeing that they're different in color. So that tells us that visual indiscriminability in color is not transitive. And that in turn tells us that visual indiscriminability in color is not the criterion of identity for perceived colors, because a criterion of identity for anything has to be a transitive relation. Right? And so we can generalize this argument that, because it's not specific to color, indiscriminability is not the criterion of identity for perceived qualities. So, for example, you could make exactly the same kind of argument about perceived shapes, where we could have C0 being clearly square and CN being clearly triangular, but where the difference is somehow the difference in shape is so small that you can't actually see the difference between any two neighboring shapes in the sequence. So that argument, that fascinated me when I encountered it as an undergraduate student. Just the sort of structure of it really appealed to me. That made me wonder whether anything could be rescued from the failed criterion of identity for perceived qualities. I mean, the argument really did show that indiscriminability is not the right criterion of identity for perceived qualities, but maybe we can still make some kind of sense of perceived qualities by in some way modifying the original idea, but not rejecting it totally. And so one thing I noticed in thinking about this idea of perceived qualities is that it's quite consistent with the logical considerations that we've just given over the argument about transitivity. It's quite consistent with that for perceptual indiscriminability to be a necessary condition for identity of perceived quality. And so what that in effect means is that if the perceived quality of X is identical with the perceived quality of Y, then X is indiscriminable from Y. In other words, you can't have a case where you can discriminate between X and Y, but their perceived quality is identical. The possibility of discriminating is in color is enough to show that there's a difference of perceived quality. In other words, we can have, as it were, if you like, half the original idea that we started with. But what the logical argument about transitivity showed is that if indiscriminability is necessary for identity of perceived quality, then it's not also sufficient. And that, I mean, the reason for that is simply that if it were both necessary and sufficient, then that would make it a criterion of identity. And we've just seen that that's impossible. So it can't be both necessary and sufficient, but it could be necessary without being sufficient. So the fact that it's not sufficient means that sometimes we've got cases where X is indiscriminable from Y. The observer can't tell the difference, but the perceived quality of X is still distinct from the perceived quality of Y. So that is kind of compromising the original idea to some extent, but it's not completely rejecting it, because we've still got that indiscriminability is necessary for identity of perceived quality. And then we might go a bit beyond just saying that it's necessary but not sufficient, and thinking of identity and perceived quality as a relation for which indiscriminability is necessary and as close as possible to sufficient. So, you know, we started out with the original criterion of identity as indiscriminability. That made indiscriminability necessary and sufficient for identity in perceived quality. We saw that idea is wrong. So the idea is to get as close to it as we can by, on the one hand, accepting that indiscriminability is necessary, and then trying to get as close as we can to sufficiency, to the other half. We know that we're not going to be able to get all the way there because of the argument about transitivity, but we might be able to get quite close to sufficiency. And so, as it were, get something like a best possible approximation to the original idea. That was the sort of strategy I was interested in. But of course, that would require that there is some relation for which indiscriminability is necessary and as close as possible to sufficient. And we can say something more about what this relation is going to have to be like. I mean, the logical considerations, they show that a criterion of identity, they show that it must be transitive, but they show more than that. They also show that to be a criterion of identity, a relation must be symmetric. So in this case, that means that if the perceived quality of X equals the perceived quality of Y, then the perceived quality of Y equals the perceived quality of X. I mean, of course, that's pretty obvious, but it's still a formally significant restriction. Identity in general is a symmetric relation. So that tells us a little bit more about what we need from this criterion of identity that's going to help us, as it were, define what these perceived qualities have to be like, or get as close as we can to defining it. And another feature of identity is that it's reflexive, that everything is identical with itself. And so that tells us that the perceived quality of X has to be identical with the perceived quality of X. It has to be identical with itself. And of course, that's only where we're talking about things that have perceived qualities. I mean, for example, maybe numbers don't have perceived qualities, and so they wouldn't be, the reflexivity wouldn't be relevant to them. So really, the reflexivity tells us that we have to be talking about some suitable domain where of objects which do have perceived qualities. We, for these purposes, we're not interested in ones which don't. We're interested in objects which have perceived colours and perceived shapes. Now, just a bit of logic terminology, that the phrase equivalence relation just means any relation which is reflexive, symmetric, and transitive. And so what we know just by the logic of identity is that a criterion of identity must be an equivalence relation, just on purely logical grounds. And what I conjectured, when I was an undergraduate, is that identity, a perceived quality, is an equivalence relation for which indiscriminability is necessary and as close to sufficient as possible. And so if we think in extensional terms, the identity of perceived quality is going to be maximal amongst equivalence relations. When we're thinking in extensional terms, we're thinking about all the pairs of things that are related by the relation, the class of pairs which have this relation, and so. Saying that this relation is maximal, it means it's as big as possible. It includes as many pairs as possible, as many things as possible are related by this relation. So it's maximal amongst equivalence relations included in indiscriminability. That is equivalence relations for which indiscriminability is necessary. So no other equivalence relation included in indiscriminability is closer to the identity of perceived qualities. So that's what this idea comes to. I'm sorry that this is a bit technical, but it's kind of difficult to see what's going on here if I don't explain this. And I mean, one thing I should say is when we're talking about identity in, let's say, perceived colour, for example, we're talking about the identity between colour samples, objects which have colour, not between the abstract colours themselves, but we're talking about the identity between, you know, coloured objects in their perceived colour. So the actual identity is, if you like, it's between the colours, the perceived colours. But we're thinking of this as a relation on the things which have the colours of having, you know, the same perceived colour. So that's a kind of sort of formal characterization of what we want indiscriminability, how we want it to constrain the identity of perceived quality. We want identity of perceived quality to be a maximal equivalence relation included in indiscriminability. In other words, it's an equivalence relation which has formal properties associated with the criterion of identity, and it's included in indiscriminability in the sense that all the things that all the pairs that have it are indiscriminable from each other. But we also want this relation to be have as big an extension as possible, so that you can't have an equivalence relation which is bigger than it and still included in indiscriminability. And we want that in order to make the criterion of identity as close as we can make it to indiscriminability, to try to capture the idea of perceived quality. And it turns out this is actually quite a problem with quite a bit of mathematical structure. And so I found that if you use the axiom of choice in set theory, I managed to prove, given that axiom, that indiscriminability does contain such a maximal equivalence relation. So in that sense, my conjecture was satisfiable, that there have to be relations which have all the formal properties that I was postulating for a criterion of identity for perceived color. The axiom of choice, I'm not going to go into what that says mathematically, but it's an axiom that is quite widely used in mathematics, but is a bit more controversial than some other axioms of set theory. As a way, it's most mathematicians are willing to use it, but it's not as sort of elementary as some other axioms of set theory. So some mathematicians are interested in doing mathematics which doesn't use the axiom of choice, but I was interested in, well, I mean, I needed to use the axiom of choice to prove this result, to prove that there are the kind of relations which can be criteria of identity in the sense that I wanted. But something else I managed to prove, it really, in fact, turned out to be very closely related, is that when indiscriminability is non-transitive, it contains more than one such maximal equivalence relation. So that my conjecture did not define a unique solution. I said what formal properties identity in perceived qualities should have, and how it should be connected with indiscriminability. And I could prove that there was at least one such relation, but in fact, it turned out that when indiscriminability is non-transitive, as the Russell, as the argument shows that it is in general, then you're always going to have more than one candidate which satisfies those formal properties. So I hadn't succeeded in identifying, one single solution to the problem. I had succeeded in identifying, as if you like, a class of candidate solutions, any of which had the properties that I was requiring. Something that a little bit later I also proved is that the existence of such maximal equivalence relations contained in a given non-transitive relation is actually equivalent to the axiom of choice. So it's not just that if you assume the axiom of choice, you can get the result that I wanted, but that if you assume the result that I wanted, then from that you can get the axiom of choice. So that what that shows is that the axiom of choice is actually necessary for using this method of approximation from within. So that means that the method will not be completely uncontroversial, because it at least in the general case, it does actually require this slightly controversial axiom of set theory. So I'm sorry about the technicality. I'll try not to be too technical, but it's difficult to explain what I was doing in that research without going into a little bit of technicality. So that was basically the first serious research that I did in philosophy, and which I did as an undergraduate. And I wrote it up as an article because I thought it would be nice to, because I'd got these formal results, it would be nice to publish it. In the article, I applied the same kind of formal techniques to other philosophical cases. such as definitions of identity over time in terms of a relation of physical or psychological continuity, which is non-transitive in cases of fission or fusion. So let me just explain very briefly about that. So, of course, there's a big philosophical discussion about personal identity. And if you think of that in terms of, if you like, person stages, as people often say, time slices of persons, then the question is what unifies these into being all stages or slices of a given a single person? And typical answers are that you need some kind of physical continuity or psychological continuity for it to be the same person. And there are debates about whether it should be physical or psychologically the continuity that really matters. And then you get problems of non-transitivity in cases where you can, in some sense, divide a person. For example, where you take the left hemisphere of their brain and divide it from the right hemisphere of the brain and transplant those into two separate bodies. And then it seems that you have physical, some physical and some maybe psychological continuity between the two resulting people and the original person. Each of the two resulting people is psychologically continuous, like we can suppose, with the original person, but they're not psychologically continuous with each other anymore. And so there's a failure of transitivity there, and you get similar effects if you can somehow, if you imagine amoebas, if you're interested in the identity of amoebas, where they join together and become one. And so although these are very different cases philosophically, metaphysically, from the case of perceived qualities, the structural problem is actually the same, that the kind of criterion of identity that we wanted to have fails for logical reasons because it's non-transitive. And then the question is, well, so since our original idea didn't quite work, what's the closest we can come to it? How can we at least approximate to the original idea? How little do we have to revise it in order to get something that works from a logical point of view? And so I discussed some of these other cases in the article, because the mathematical apparatus that I developed applied just as well to these other examples as to the original example of perceived colors. But I had a somewhat funny attitude to the article I was writing, because these formal problems, they really emerge in the context of a kind of reductionist metaphysics, which is looking for such methods, where you're a reductionist metaphysics, where you're trying to reduce things like perceived qualities or persons who persist over time and so on, when you're trying to reduce them to something like logical constructions out of what are supposed to be more basic things, such as the indiscriminability of colors or the psychological continuity of stages and so on. So by the time I was actually writing this article, which was, you know, maybe a year or two later, I'm still an undergraduate, I had become less sympathetic, more skeptical about that kind of reductionism in metaphysics. And so in a way, I felt more distanced from the research that I'd originally done, even though I thought it was still interesting as, you know, as showing what the possibilities are for this kind of reductionist metaphysics. But I was less convinced that reductionist metaphysics was the right way to go anyway. So having written this article, I submitted it to the Journal of Philosophy, which I regarded as the best journal at that time for the relevant areas of philosophy. Very likely it was the best journal at that time. And so a few months later, I received a letter, I now know that it was basically a revise and resubmit letter, as they're called, which is a very encouraging thing. And they just wanted me to say more in the article about the philosophical significance of these formal results, which I'd actually been a bit cautious about because I was a bit skeptical about the reductionist metaphysics that was the framework for raising these questions. But I was still an undergraduate, so I didn't really know anything about how to publish an article in philosophy. So I didn't understand. I didn't show it to anybody. I just got this letter, and I didn't understand that it was in fact a very encouraging thing to get, and so I misunderstood it as some kind of patronizing rejection, and basically did nothing about it. I just left it. Seems very naive now that I reacted in that way, but I, as I say, I just didn't understand how publishing worked because I had no experience of that. About 10 years later, when I was already in my first teaching job at Trinity College Dublin, by then I was well aware of the value of a revise and resubmit verdict from a top journal. So I realized, well, although 10 years had passed, I still could revise and resubmit the paper. So I did, and it was published in the Journal of Philosophy as Criteria of Identity in the Axiom of Choice. It finally came out in 1986. So as it were, in that sense, it was a happy ending, but if I'd known what a revise and resubmit was, it could have come out in 1976. Working on the, just to do a final revision of that article, that made me start thinking again about indiscriminability. But then I started thinking about it not anymore from the perspective of reductionist metaphysics, but from the perspective of epistemic logic, of, that's to say, crudely speaking, the logic of knowledge, which is basically a branch of modal logic, where we interpret the necessity operator as something like, you know, meaning I know that, or something of that kind. Although you can also interpret it in terms of I believe that, which that makes it doxastic logic. This is a branch, the epistemic and doxastic logic, really. They're branches of modal logic, which in their modern form were pioneered by the Finnish philosopher Jaakko Hintikker, particularly in a book that he published in, I think, 1962, called Knowledge and Belief. I'd got interested in epistemic logic in between, you know, and so one thing I realized that one could explain the logical features of indiscriminability in terms of its relation to knowledge. So this is how I started thinking about indiscriminability in the 1980s. Once I'd come back to this topic after a long gap, because you know in the original discussions, particularly the ones about logical constructions, and then I was following the same framework. Indiscriminability was treated just as some kind of primitive relation. It wasn't really analyzed. It was at all. But it seemed to me that actually one could understand why it has the formal features that it does if you think of it in terms of knowledge. So let me explain how that works. Sorry, this is, again, it's going to have to be a little bit technical, but the basic ideas are actually quite simple. So I'm going to just let Q stand for a type of quality, so colors or shapes. So when I use the phrase Q of X, I mean the relevant quality of an object, such as its color or shape. So the object X is some particular object, you know, a particular in, you know, at a particular place at a particular time and so on. But this object has qualities such as color and shape. And so you could just imagine that Q here is standing in for color, or if you prefer, it's standing in for shape. And so we're using it to go from the particular, maybe physical object or whatever, to there's some of the people interested, the logical empiricists would have thought of it as a particular sense datum or quali or whatever, rather than an external object. I'm not going to be concerned with those issues, but if X is some kind of particular, and then Q of X is the relevant quality of that particular. And so the way I wanted to relate discrimination and indiscriminability to knowledge is like this. The basic idea is that to discriminate X and Y in Q, in other words, to discriminate between them in color or in shape, that is really to activate knowledge of a given kind that they differ in Q. So, for example, if we're talking about perceived qualities in of visual kind, so it would be that one knows by sight that QX is distinct from Q of Y. For example, that the color, when one knows by sight that the color of X is different from the color of Y. And when I talk about activating knowledge, I just mean either acquiring knowledge, getting knowledge in the first place, coming to know this, or if you happen already to know it, then activating it could be, as it were, kind of, as it were, reviving the knowledge that you already had. So discriminating is knowing in the relevant way that the objects are distinct in a certain respect. And so indiscriminability, I mean, the in here is, I mean, that means that it's not possible to discriminate them. So X is indiscriminable in, let's say, color from Y, if one cannot activate such knowledge, as it were, for all one knows in the relevant way, let's say the color of X is the color of Y. So this is where you're in your circumstances, you're not able to know that they're different. So that means it's, you know, compatible with everything you know, that they're the same. For all you know, they're the same. And so that's a connection between knowledge and indiscriminability. And And really what we're talking about is that indiscriminability in Q, for example, in color, is a kind of epistemic possibility of identity, let's say in color. And we can write that as diamond for epistemic possibility of the identity in color. So roughly speaking, the idea is indiscriminability in a given respect is the epistemic possibility of identity in that respect. And it turns out that this kind of little fairly, you know, on the surface analysis of indiscriminability enables one to explain the logic of indiscriminability in terms of epistemic logic and the logic of identity. So we're actually able to go a bit deeper than indiscriminability, not to treat it as a primitive, but to start off with epistemic logic and the logic of identity, which are both independently fairly well understood, and use that to explain the logic of indiscriminability. I'll say some more about how this actually works, how we can give such explanations. So reflexivity, that's just a principle. X is indiscriminable in the relevant respect, for example, in color from itself. And so that's just a principle that it's epistemically possible that X is identical in color with itself. And so, of course, this is pretty trivial. But technically, if we wanted to do it, we're going to have, at least on the relevant domain, that let's say the color of X, the perceived color of X, is the perceived color of Y. And that will be just a theorem by the logic of identity. And if it's a theorem that they're identical, we can also derive that it's possible for them to be identical. I mean, if they really are identical, then of course it has to be possible for them to be identical. And so the logical principle that we're using there is that if A is a theorem of our logic, then so is possibly A, that will definitely hold an epistemic logic, which is the logic of knowledge, because if anything is the case, then it's consistent with everything that we know that it's the case, and so it's epistemically possible, and that actually uses the fact that that knowledge implies truth, so that if something is true, it's also consistent with everything we know, because everything we know is also true. This particular principle doesn't really require the full idea of knowledge, because if we think of doxastic logic as the logic of consistent belief, we're thinking about agents whose beliefs are always consistent with each other, we could also get this principle for if we interpreted the diamond not in terms of knowledge, but in terms of belief, i.e. as it's consistent with everything the agent believes that A, provided that we're talking about agents whose beliefs are internally consistent. Because if something is a theorem, then it's also going to be possible. it's going to be consistent with everything that the agent believes, because if it were inconsistent with something the agent believes, then there'd be an inconsistency in the agent's beliefs themselves, if it's actually a logical theorem. But we wouldn't get this principle if we were just talking about doxastic logic as the logic of sort of doxastic possibility of what's consistent with what you believe, where there's no, if we had no restriction to consistent agents, because if you have an inconsistent agent, then nothing is doxastically possible. And so even the identity of, you know, Q of X and with Q itself would not be doxastically possible for an inconsistent agent, because nothing is consistent with everything that they believe, because their beliefs are internally inconsistent. So this kind of reflexivity that I've been talking about, that X is indiscriminable in the given respect for it, from itself, that actually you can make sense of that if you interpret indiscriminability in terms of knowledge, but you could also make sense of it if you interpreted indiscriminability in terms of belief, but a doxastic possibility, but the belief of consistent agents. But it wouldn't work if you were considering inconsistent agents inconsistent in their beliefs. But that kind of reflexivity, that's a bit, it's kind of a bit boring and trivial, whereas there's actually a more interesting principle which sounds very similar to reflexivity, but it's slightly different. So this is where we're talking about two different objects. For example, two different color samples. I mean, not they don't have to be different in color, but they have to be different in, you know, for example, you know, one of them's on the right and the other is the one on the left or something like that. In that sense, they're distinct particulars. And so here the principle is that if two objects, X and Y, are the same in, let's say, in color, then they're indiscriminable in color. So if X is identical in color to Y, then X is indiscriminable in color from Y. And that principle also seems to be correct. If X and Y are identical in color, then you can't discriminate them in color. You might think that you have, but you haven't really, because there is no difference in the color. And so to get this more interesting form, which I've called strong reflexivity, we can get this principle if we assume the principle that A implies the possibility of A. And that holds in epistemic logic, because what's known must be true, and so whatever is true, it follows that it's epistemically possible. But that principle does not work in doxastic logic, even if we're talking about consistent agents, because doxastic possibility just means that something is consistent with everything that the agent believes, but the fact that something is true doesn't mean that it's consistent with everything that the agent believes, because the agent might have some false beliefs, and so one reason why this strong reflexivity is more interesting than the original form of reflexivity is that to get it, you actually need the power of epistemic logic, where you're thinking of the possibility in terms of knowledge, and you can't just get it in doxastic logic, where you're thinking of the possibility in terms of belief, even consistent belief. So just to get a feel of this principle, it's saying if X is identical in color to Y, You can't know that X is not identical in color to Y, but you might consistently believe that X is not identical in color to Y. That's why this principle works for knowledge, but it doesn't work even for consistent belief. And so it seems to me that this principle of strong reflexivity, of indiscriminability, is pretty compelling. And this is really evidence that indiscriminability it concerns knowledge and not just belief. And this actually became very important to me as some evidence in favor of the kind of knowledge first program that I developed later, which I'll be talking about in lecture four, I think. So as I said, that's because discrimination, that seems like a very, very basic kind of cognition in a way. It's one of the most fundamental things that we have to be able to do in cognition is to make discriminations. And so if at this very basic level of discrimination, we're really already working with something that involves knowledge, that's a kind of early hint in favor of a knowledge first approach to epistemology. Now, just as it were to tidy this up, the converse of strong reflexivity does not hold. In other words, if it's epistemically possible that X and Y are the same in color, that doesn't imply that they really are the same in color. And so if X is indiscriminable in color from Y, it doesn't follow that X is identical in color to Y. This is identity in color in the more objective sense, when we're not just talking about perceived colors here. And this is just a note for people who are interested in the semantics of modal logic. So if you're not, then don't worry about this. But So in order to understand what's going on here, you in semantic terms, you have to know that the Q, these terms Q of X and Q of Y, they're non-rigid designators. In other words, they can vary in what they designate from one epistemically possible world to another. And what that corresponds to is the idea that the agent may not know exactly which color is the color of X. There are different colors, which or any of which could be the color of X. And when you implement that in the framework of possible worlds, epistemically possible worlds, sort of semantics for epistemic logic, you would get that these are non-rigid designators. Another logical feature of indiscriminability is that if X is indiscriminable from Y, then Y is indiscriminable from X. And when you analyze indiscriminability in the way that I was suggesting, what that corresponds to is the principle that if it's epistemically possible for X and Y to be identical, let's say in color, then it's epistemically possible for Y and X to be identical in color, which of course is pretty trivial. The reason that this holds is simply that, well, just from the logic of identity, if QX is identical to QY, then QY is identical to QX because identity is symmetry. And then we could just use a principle which actually holds in both epistemic and doxastic logic, that if A implies B, then the epistemic or doxastic possibility of A implies the epistemic or doxastic possibility of B. That, you know, if A implies B and A is consistent with everything that the agent knows or believes, then B will be consistent with everything that the agent knows or believes. So although it's a bit trivial, it's nice to be able to actually show how that we can in fact prove this in epistemic and doxastic logic. It's not something that we have to take as just a primitive axiom. We can prove it from more basic facts about the logic of identity and the logic of, I mean, the epistemic or doxastic logic. Now, I think the most interesting question is when we come to the non-transitivity issue, the issue which as we produced this whole problem in the first place. And so what non-transitivity of indiscriminability tells us is that in terms of the analysis, is that if it's, I'll talk about epistemically possible now because that's the one we're really interested in. If it's epistemically possible that, let's say this in terms of color, that X and Y are identical in color, and it's epistemically possible that Y and Z are identical in color, that does not imply that it's epistemically possible that X and Z are identical in color. And so we need to think a bit carefully about what's going on here. Because, of course, what is completely straightforward is that if X and Y are identical in color and Y and Z are identical in color, then it follows that X and Z are identical in color. So we've got transitivity at the level of identity in color. But when we start talking about, when we go to indiscriminability, we're talking about the epistemic possibility of identity. And then we don't get the transitivity, even though it holds for identity. And so what's going on is when we say that it's epistemically possible for X and Y to be, let's say, identical in color, that in terms of the possible worlds, that means that there are some epistemically possible worlds where X and Y are identical in color. And if it's also epistemically possible for Y and Z to be identical in color, then there are some epistemically possible worlds where they're identical in color. But the thing is that it may be that there are no epistemically possible worlds where both identities hold together. Although there are some where X and Y are identical in color and others where Y and Z are identical in color, there may be no worlds where they're both identical in color. And I mean, this really corresponds to the fact that if A is possible and B is possible, it doesn't mean that the conjunction of A and B has to be possible, because A and B might, for example, be inconsistent with each other. And so that's why, even though identity in color, let's say, is transitive, indiscriminability in color isn't transitive. Because of this problem of the possible worlds in question not overlapping. So there may be no epistemically possible worlds where X and Z are identical in color. I mean, if there are some worlds where both X and Y are identical in color and also in the same worlds that Y and Z are identical in color, then of course that means that would mean that there were some worlds where X and Z are identical in color, because identity in color is a transitive relation. But there may not be any overlap of that kind. And so so we can see why the non-transitivity of indiscriminability is something that we basically have expected in terms of this analysis of indiscriminability, in terms of the epistemic possibility of identity because of the logic of possibility, that two possibilities may not agglomerate. They may each be possible, but their conjunction of the conjunction of the two things that are possible may not itself be possible. And that's the fundamental logical reason on this analysis for the non-transitivity of indiscriminability. So we don't just have to rely on, as it were, actual or imaginable examples where it fails. We can understand in this structural logical way why that principle ought to fail, why we should have been able to predict that it would fail even before we thought of any examples where it did fail. There's quite a lot of advantage in we can get a lot of understanding of discrimination and indiscriminability and their structural features by using this analysis. So remember that, just to put it very briefly, that indiscriminability in Q, where Q might be shape or color or whatever, indiscriminability in Q is to be understood as the epistemic possibility of identity in Q. So actually that means that trying to reduce identity in Q to indiscriminability in Q, like identity in color, for example, in perceived color to indiscriminability, that's the wrong direction of explanation. Because we're actually, in effect, we're understanding indiscriminability in terms of the possibility of identity. And so we shouldn't think of things the other way around. And so when I wrote Identity and Discrimination, which, as I say, came out in 1990, so that was after I'd come back to this issue and started thinking about it again, I explored how indiscriminability, for example, in colour or shape, fits into the more general epistemology of colour or shape. But I was taking the, as it were, the objective colors and shapes as a starting point, and then thinking about the epistemology of those things, and then understanding indiscriminability in terms of that. So it was, as it were, taking the more objective part as a starting point, rather than the subjective relation of indiscriminability the program of logical construction that I'd originally been interested in wanted to do. So if one's interested in approaching indiscriminability in that kind of way, where starting from the questions of the identity of something more objective and then thinking of how those identities and non-identities may be epistemically possible or not. So as it were, approaching it from the standpoint of epistemology, then we get, we're interested in questions like, well, if X is red and Y is indiscriminable in color from X, then Y is red too. Is that a valid principle? Which is a kind of principle that combines indiscriminability and other, indiscriminability in color and color properties and so on. So that kind of principle that if X is red and Y is indiscriminable in color from X, then Y is red too. They figure in discussions on the problem of vagueness, because they generate paradoxes, because you can show that if the first member of the sequence of color samples is red, then all the subsequent ones have to be, and then the last one has to be red as well, and vice versa, in the opposite direction. So So people have been interested in those. I mean, by the way, if you do apply the kind of analysis of indiscriminability in terms of the epistemic possibility of identity that I've been arguing for, then you would not expect that principle, that tolerance principle, to work. So in Identity and Discrimination, I was interested in exploring these principles in the setting of epistemic logic. But I was also having my sort of first tentative engagement with the problem of vagueness, which I'll be talking about more next time. In that book, I also applied my previously developed formal techniques for treating the non-transitivity problem for criteria of identity, more generally, including to new cases, but in a less reductionist spirit. I mean, I managed to show that even if you abandoned the kind of reductionism that I'd become suspicious of, there was still some role that these principles could play. You could still apply them, but just from working from a different perspective. And an example of another kind where the same formal issues arise is according to the one theory of the individuation of species. I mean, there are within evolutionary biology, there are different theories about how you divide animals into species, but one that has quite a lot of currency amongst biologists is just the idea that if you have two populations that they belong to the same species, if and only if they can interbreed successfully. By successfully, I mean that the offspring also have to be fertile. So, for example, with horses and donkeys, they can interbreed, but the results are, for example, mules, which can't interbreed anymore. But interbreeding successfully means that they can have fertile offspring. And so this is one quite well-known approach within biology to individuating species. But it actually has the very same structural problem that I've been interested in these, as were cases that arise more in philosophy, that it's non-transitive. And in fact, there are real life examples of non-transitivity. So, for example, there are a whole lot of different populations of birds, P0, P1, P2 to PN, which are found around the edge of the Gobi desert, and where P0 can interbreed with P1, P1 can interbreed with P2, and so on, and then PN-1 can interbreed with PN, but P0 cannot interbreed with PN. As I say, this is a real life case which I read about in a biology textbook. It's not simply some kind of invented philosopher's example. But it has exactly the same kind of structure that I'd been interested in. And so the kind of formal techniques that I've been working, I mean, they could be applied to that case as well, as so that one could get a kind of approximation to the interbreeding criterion of identity for species that would be logically okay, that would not lead to those kind of inconsistencies in classification, and that would come as close to it as possible. Another issue, and this, of course, that would, this would in fact arise even for that biological case, that that I was dealing with in the book is that my general formal techniques for treating the non-transitivity problem, another way in which they raised the problem of vagueness was because they didn't give a unique solution. So, for example, in the case of the populations of birds, because of the non-transitivity, you could get a kind of criterion of identity that would be, in a sense, a best possible approximation to the interbreeding criterion. But you could actually get several different ones, which would, the kind of formal methods that I was using didn't specify which of those would be the best. They might, in fact, be equally good. And so it seemed to be vague which maximal equivalence relation was the criterion of identity, because I didn't have criteria which would distinguish amongst the different possible criterion of identity which met all my formal requirements. So one question which I raised in the book was whether this vagueness was really kind of some kind of intrinsic indeterminacy, where there was no correct answer as to which of these was the criterion of identity, or was it just our ignorance as to which solution was correct? So, you know, on the ignorance view, there would be one correct answer. It's just that we wouldn't know which it was. And whereas on the indeterminacy view, there would be no unique correct answer. And so in the book, I left the question open, and that's really leaving open what kind of understanding of vagueness we're to have. So I didn't, as it were, commit myself fully as to which was the correct approach to vagueness. I just allowed these two possibilities. Another case that I also considered in the book are where you get structurally similar problems. They arise for questions of identity across times or possible worlds. So for example, this could arise for questions of the identity of a language, because like English or Chinese, because when we're talking about whether the same language is spoken at different times, and you know, we know that language is changing in subtle ways all the time, and so little changes seem to be consistent with having the same language. But if we imagine a language changing, you know, maybe over thousands of years, to the point where the way it's spoken at the end of this process, it is radically different from the way that it is at the beginning, so that speakers at one end would not be able to make any sense of what the speakers at the other end were saying. Then that seems to be, you know, a similar problem of non-transitivity, and you can also have problems like that with artifacts, where if you change what they're made of a little bit, you might get the same artifact, but if you change what they're made of a lot, you get a different artifact. So, for example, you know, the chair that you're sitting on, it seems that very chair, you know, it would be the you know, could have been this, or let's say maybe an easier case is you know, a motor car, where if you change you know, one piece, you know, maybe it's the same car, but if you change it radically enough, you seem to get a different artifact. And we also, we could ask questions not just about change over time, but about change over, if you like, possible worlds, where we ask, could this same artifact, the same ship, for example, could it have originally been made from slightly different materials? And you know, the kind of natural answer is yes. But if we think of it as having been made originally from radically different materials and in a radically different shape and so on, then the answer seems to be no. And so, and that's another case where we're getting these problems of transitivity. So basically, small changes seem to preserve identity of artifacts, while large changes seem to destroy identity. But the trouble is that many small changes add up to a large change. So all of these are problems of non-transitivity. So the book engaged with many themes that have continued to fascinate me, but it engaged with it in a rather open-ended, tentative way, because I really wasn't sure what the best approach was. And I think that was one thing that rather limited the impact of my first book. I mean, it was, you know, it had some impact, but I think it did not have a very clear message, because I hadn't really decided what was the best approach. So I was exploring different options, but kind of in a way just leaving it open which of them was the best option. In my later work, I've come to some much more definite conclusions. And so in my later books, I've always been arguing for a very definite view and not leaving things open in the same way. And I think that's one reason that the later books have had more impact than my first book. Okay, so that's the end of the lecture. I've tried to be a little briefer than last time because I hope that we'll have more time to answer questions from people who are listening than we had last time. Right. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Williamson. Yes, I gave a short, very short introduction to Williamson's interlocutor. Professor Liu Xiaofei receives his PhD in philosophy from the University of Missouri, Columbia. He is currently a professor of philosophy at Wuhan University. Previously, he taught at the philosophy department of Xiamen University from 2013 to 2021. He works in moral philosophy and metaphysics with special interests in moral responsibility and free will, discrimination, and experimental ethics. He has published a Chinese book on moral responsibility in the very prestigious Chinese publishers, the Commercial Press. And also published some articles in English on very good journals, such as Mind, Philosophical Studies, Philosophical Psychology, and others. Now, we welcome Professor Liu Xiaofei to give some comments and questions. Okay.
Thanks, Professor Chen Po. Thanks very much. And thank you, Professor Williamson, for this very clear and interesting talk. So since you are going to give another talk on vagueness next week, so I'll refrain myself from asking questions on the your proposed solution to the sorites paradox in your first book, Identity and Discrimination. I find the solution fascinating. So let me start with some clarification questions. So on slide number 50, you give this, a definition of indiscriminability in terms of epistemic logic of identity. So says that X is indiscriminable in Q from Y if one cannot activate a piece of knowledge that X is not identical in Q from Y, right? So I just want a little bit of clarification on this. What do you mean by one, especially this one here? Does the epistemic quantifier, the diamond, means if there does not exist somebody who cannot activate such a knowledge? Or do you mean if nobody can activate such a knowledge? So is it sort of, it is impossible for anybody to activate such a knowledge, or is it not the case that some particular person cannot activate that knowledge? So that's my first question.
Put your all question.
I have six or seven questions. I don't know if I don't know which is the best way to pursue. But
maybe it's easier for the audience if I answer them as you.
Right.
Because then they'll remember what the question was. And right. So I think the answer to that is that in epistemic and doxastic logic, we're not specifying, you know, who the agent is, or what their circumstances are, but we are, as you were imagining, that it's held fixed, that we've got a particular agent and in particular circumstances, and then we're laying down principles which would apply to, you know, general principles which would apply to, as we're to any given agent in any given circumstances, so that the interpretation of the diamond, in terms of epistemic possibility, it doesn't involve any generalization over agents. It's just saying that the given agent in the given circumstances can't come to know something, or it's consistent, or rather it's possible. I mean, it's consistent with everything that they know, maybe, or know in some relevant way in those circumstances. The diamond by itself doesn't involve any quantification over agents.
Okay, that's great. Thanks. So I'm asking this because this is related to my second question. So I'll read this. I think it's a problem. I want to see what you think about it. So on slide number 56, so there you give this description of strong reflexivity. So the strong reflexivity says that, quote, if X is identical in Q to Y, then X is indiscriminable in Q from Y. So I wonder, so if we say if A then B, then it implies if not B, then not A, right? So, but I find the second phrase a little bit more problematic. So the second phrase, if we flip it, should read like this. If one can activate a piece of knowledge that X is different in Q from Y, then X is not identical in Q to Y. Now that seems to me a little bit more problematic. So suppose that it seems to everybody in this world that waves are different from particles in perceived physical qualities. But from an omniscient being's point of view, so you invoked the omniscient being in your proposed solution to the sorites paradox. Maybe from that point of view, they are actually just identical. It seems reasonable to say that, given our circumstances, we know that waves are different from particles in those perceived physical qualities. So that seems to present a problem for the flip of the strong reflexivity. So I wonder what are you going to say to that?
So the strong. I mean, if you contrapose it, as you were suggesting, what you get is the principle that if it's epistemically necessary that X and Y differ in the relevant quality, then they do differ in the relevant quality. And that is just an instance of the principle that if something is epistemically necessary, then it's true. And that principle is pretty solid, but I mean, it just basically follows because epistemically necessary means that it, as it were, it follows from what one knows that something is the case. And I mean, knowledge is factive in the sense that if one only knows something if it's true, and so of course whatever follows from truths is itself true. So I think the contraposed principle is fine. I think with your example of the waves and the particles, I think you were kind of there was a little bit of sort of instability in whether you were talking about what people knew or how things appeared to them. And I mean, of course, if we understood the indiscriminability in terms of what's consistent with how things appear to you, then this principle would not work because how things appear to you may be false. and so it would mean that we were interpreting the diamond, if we're doing it in terms of appearances, that would work more like doxastic possibility, where, you know, because something can be doxastically possible, but even though it's false. But if we're talking about epistemic possibility, which is, you know, the intended reading, then you can't have that. And, you know, the fact that that everything seems a certain way to people doesn't mean that that's epistemically necessary for them because seeing isn't the same as knowledge. So I think that's what's going on with that example.
Okay, great. Just a technical point. So now when you put it as epistemic necessity, that seems to follow, right? Seems to follow. But then maybe there's some. The reason I ask the first question is how we should understand this if one cannot activate such knowledge. So it really seems to me you think knowledge is not contingent upon the circumstance of the knower or the actor, the agent, right? He implies that. And the work, the epistemic necessity guarantees identity. The work is done by the presupposition that a knowledge requires truth. That's how I understand that.
Yes.
Right. Maybe there is some, a little bit of work needs to do to clarify my first question. Maybe it's not, but I'm not sure about that. But I do have a slightly different concern that it seems to me, so you initially talk about rescuing the criterion of identity for perceived quality. So the logical empiricists, their idea, they are trying to define identity on the basis of indiscriminability. And that there is a certain kind of subjectivity in that. But when sort of we define identity, or as you think that project doesn't go that way, we should go the opposite direction, that we should define indiscriminability in terms of epistemic logic of identity. Right, so, but now intuitively we seem to understand indiscriminability in terms of a kind of subjective concept. So I wonder why you think we should go this way, like defining indiscriminability in terms of epistemological identity. How much does this preserve the spirit of the logical empiricist project?
There are several things there. So one is, you were asking about the one in the interpretation of, you know, what one can know. So the one just represents the given agent, whoever the given agent happens to be, in the same way as when one uses the present tense, you know, whether the agent knows that. That doesn't mean that we're talking specifically about the actual present time. I mean, we're just talking about the relevant time, you know, which could be any particular time. It doesn't have to be in 2021 or anything. So it's very much part of the way I'm understanding epistemic possibility that it does depend on the circumstances of the knower. So, for example, you know, if we're talking about visual discrimination, that depends on, you know, things like lighting conditions, you know, what discriminations you can make. So one way in which indiscriminability, I mean, there's a subjective aspect to it, or at least, you know, an aspect which varies according to the individual and the time and the circumstances, because what is known depends on who the knower is and what, you know, what circumstances they're in. And so that captures the way in which indiscriminability what's indiscriminable depends on who's doing the discriminating and what circumstances they're doing the discriminating in, although it's not purely subjective, because, you know, we are talking about knowledge, you know, and not simply about how things appear to people. And in answer to your final question about, well, does this preserve the spirit of logical empiricism? Then I think the answer is fundamentally no, it doesn't. You know, and I don't want it to, because, you know, I was talking about, you know, the way I became disillusioned with the kind of reductionist metaphysics that was the original framework for these investigations, I mean, that, a lot of that was becoming disillusioned with the starting point of logical empiricism. So, you know, so I, in a way, I was showing how, you know, the same formal questions arise, even if one's approaching things in a much less logical empiricist way. And, you know, and so, for example, you know, I don't think you have to be a logical empiricist, you know, to be interested in questions about the individuation of species or something like that.
Okay, thank you very much. So now I ask you, proceed to a few less formal questions I sent you about. Since we are on this topic of the truth condition of knowledge, so I want to say a little bit about this. So coming from the Chinese background, I can't help but notice a very strong realist inclination in analytic philosophy. So the standard analysis of knowledge requires a truth, right? So to know that P requires that P be true, which a lot of Chinese students I taught and I have talked to find who are new to analytic epistemology find this very surprising, this condition very surprising. I think a number of them or many of them have a strong sympathy towards the view that knowledge can be false. I think this is perhaps fair to say that this sort of anti-realist intuition amongst the Chinese students constitutes quite an obstacle for them to appreciate some of the most important debates in analytic philosophy. So I wonder if you could help the audience in China to better see the appeal of this kind of realism. For example, the... Yes.
So of course, one thing that where I can't comment is about how exactly, you know, what the right translation of the term know in English would be into Chinese. And, you know, and so so of course one possibility is that it's actually being translated by a term that doesn't, you know, capture. Although, I mean, I'm pretty sure that that there will be a good translation, you know, into Chinese. But one thing I want to emphasize is that the idea that, you know, that S knows that P is true, can be true only if P is true. That's not something that is something that Western philosophers specifically have come up with. It's something that is very generally acknowledged amongst linguists, and is treated not simply as a feature of the word know in English, but as, you know, it seems that some word, some equivalent of know is pretty much a linguistic universal in all human languages. And so this is something, as I say, it's recognized by linguists. They don't have any particular commitment to, you know, a realist metaphysics or anything like that. I think, of course, one thing that, you know, one can experience with Western undergraduates as well is that many of them are influenced by kind of relativist ideas, you do often find students saying things like, that 1,000 years ago, people, you know, many people knew that the Earth was flat, but of course it's not really, you know, it's not flat and so on. And so I think what's actually going, and I mean, you get people in, you know, kind of saying things like that in English as well. And I think what's going on is that they're kind of picking up on a sort of, you know, inverted commas use of the term no, where, which is, these inverted comma uses, they're not, it's not something specific to no, it's something that, you know, applies to almost any term that we can use. So for example, we, you know, if I, you know, somebody's telling a story and, you know, and said, you know, I, for example, let's say I opened, you know, the doorbell rang and I opened the door and there was a policeman, and then the policeman came into the house, and then suddenly I realized it wasn't a policeman, it was a criminal dressed as a policeman or something like that. And so when they said, you know, a policeman came into the house, that was a kind of inverted commas use, because they don't, you know, it wasn't in fact a policeman, it was just it was a criminal dressed as a policeman, but they're calling it saying a policeman because that was how they thought of it at the time. And so, you know, often we, when we're discussing you know, other alternative perspectives, you know, maybe just our own perspective at an earlier time or something like that, we often use these kind of projective uses of words, you know, in this case, just the word policeman, to, you know, to convey how things seem to the person in question. And so, of course, one can do that with no as well, because, you know, we could say, you know, 1,000 years ago, people knew with inverted commas that the Earth was flat, because we're just describing, as it were, how things seemed from their perspective, and so I think some people have kind of misinterpreted the term knowledge, you know, as if those were kind of literal uses rather than projective uses. And so I think that's may be going on with these students, and I don't think it's just Chinese students. You can get that with you know, Western students as well. Of course, there may be some sort of deeper relativism which you find with Western students as well. But so it's, you know, there's a question about just what's going on with these students. But I may be wrong about this, but my kind of initial hypothesis is that what you're describing in these students are reactions that are quite, you know, familiar from Western students too, in my experience. And as I say, I think there's a kind of relatively easy to deal with thing, which is just that people get confused because they fail to identify these projective uses, which, and as I say, are nothing particular to do with the word no. They can, any word can be used in a projective way. But I think it's also that many students, unfortunately, are, you know, are attracted by quite extreme relativist views, and, you know, and if they have such relativist views, that then they may well, you know, be very resistant to the kind of, as it were, standard ways of talking about knowledge. But you know, I think that, you know, I think one test that may help to bring this out is if you think about knowledge WH, for example, you know, like knowledge who or knowledge whether or something like that. You know, when we ask whether, you know, for example, does so and so, do they know whether the lecture will start at 6 o'clock or something? We certainly don't mean, do they have an opinion about it? You know, we actually mean, do they know the right answer? And that's essential to how we use these phrases like knowing when and knowing whether and so on. And I think when you see that's going on, that's actually a manifestation of the factiveness of no and similar terms that they're truth entailing. And I feel rather confident that you'd find something similar going on in Chinese. So I could be wrong about this, but I don't think that it's actually, you know, some deep cultural difference between, you know, the Chinese and Western people. I think it's probably things that are actually quite familiar in the West too. But you know, when you work at it, you can see that this just is a very basic feature of how no, and many other words as well, like remember and see and so on, are used.
Okay, good. I don't want to take up too much time. I just make one brief comment on this before I get to my final question. So when linguists, they talk about factivity, they often, I think they are not talking about that. To say X knows Y, it implies Y is objectively true. They often say that to say X knows Y presupposes the speaker believes Y be true. So it seems that there are still some differences between what the speaker believes to be true and whether Y is objectively true. So I'll leave this to the audience. If somebody wants to pick up on this, I'll let the audience pursue this. So let me get to my final question. So since the topic is on your first book, so I'll ask a question on this. Currently, junior professors in China, they face great pressure in publishing journal articles. Writing a book, by comparison, receives relatively little recognition from the official evaluation metrics. So consequently, the default mindset of many junior philosophers here, when it comes to planning a research project, is that does this project fit into a paper length piece? And if not, it will often be put to the end of one's to-do list. So I wonder if you have any suggestions for junior professors, like philosophers in China, about the choice between working on a paper length project that tries to fix a relatively small problem and working on a book length project that ends at a bigger question. Which do you think is more valuable for somebody at the early stage of their career?
Yeah. So I think, I mean, in my experience, at an early stage, you know, just a few years after people have finished their PhDs, I think most people are really... What's natural for them to write are articles at that stage, and I think, you know, it would, of course, there are other kinds of pressure. I mean, even in the West as well, there are pressures on people to get publications fairly quickly. But you know, with most of my students, at the time when they finish their doctorates, they, you know, I don't feel that they're ready to write a book, and they're not really wanting to write a book. They're wanting to write articles. And in fact, there's been an increasing trend in British universities to follow the American model, where you can get a PhD your dissertation can just consist of a group of articles. Doesn't have to be a kind of book. And I think, I think there are dangers with starting too early to write a book. I mean, one is just that books are hard to write, and you can often get sort of stuck because you feel you need to write a chapter about such and such, but you're not really in a position to write it. And I think another aspect of this, of course, is that apart from the issue of having a good CV and so on, of course, really when we publish things, we're hoping that people will read them. And I think a very young philosopher who has no sort of reputation yet, if they publish a book, probably not many people are going to read that book, because they, reading a book is quite an investment of time and energy. And, if you have no idea who this person is who wrote it, you're not very inclined to make that investment when you don't know how good it is. Whereas I think once, if it's just an article, it's an article in a good journal, then the fact that it's in the journal is already evidence that it's worth reading, and reading an article is not such a big commitment as reading a whole book. So I think that it, in that way as well, it makes sense to start by publishing articles. In my own case, for example, my Knowledge and Its Limits, that's most of what's in Knowledge and Its Limits had already appeared in article form. But the book did in fact have much more impact than the original articles. I mean, they had some, but it had a massively more impact, because it presented a kind of unified picture, and so people could see how all these different ideas all fitted together. But at the same time, the book might not have been read so much if people hadn't already having some kind of idea of what I was doing, because these articles had appeared in good journals. And so I think, as it were, publishing some articles is kind of good advertising for a subsequent book. From the point of view of if somebody does have some kind of unified big picture about some area, then probably they should write a book at some point to give that big picture. And but I don't think it's something that we should expect very young philosophers to do, but partly because of the pressures you said, but also I think it takes time for them to establish themselves and get the kind of reputation which will motivate people to read the book as well. So I don't think it's as it were too oppressive for people to be pushed into writing articles rather than books at an early stage of their career. I think it's fine for the books to come later.
Okay, thank you very much. That's all my questions.
Yes, I like to ask a question about the leverage law. Two laws. The one is maybe indiscriminable of identity. If X and Y are identical, then they have same qualities and properties. The other is if X and Y have exactly same property and qualities, then they are identical. But the especially the first one, it is questionable of identity. If X and Y are identical, then they have the exactly same property and quality. seems not coherent with our ordinary sense. For example, Chenbo as a child, as a youth, as a middle-aged man, as an old guy, change a lot. Also, a river become in the years, become wider, narrow. All the its colors become thick. So how to explain away the apparent conflict of Leibniz law with the ordinary sensation?
So I think the conflicts are just an artifact of carelessness about how one uses the tense or temporal language. So that, you know, so for example, you know, somebody may be maybe very small when they're a baby and much larger when they're an adult. But if we describe that in tense language, we should say they are large, but they were small, and there's no conflict between the properties of being large and having been small. Those are completely consistent with each other. So if we're careful about the tenses, there's no conflict. And if we don't do it with tenses, but with time relativization, we can simply say, you know, if they're, let's say they're a baby at time t0 and they're an adult at time tn, then they have the properties of being small at t0 and of being large at tn, and again those are consistent. So I think that those apparent conflicts with the indiscernibility of identicals, I think they can all be resolved just by being careful about the time reference.
But time, yes, put the time reference, but still have a problem. How to combine the object with different time reference into a same object? Some philosopher divided the individual into different slices or different stages. Tempo T0, tempo T1, T2, TTN, different stages, different slices, but still have a problem. How these different stage, different slices into the same person?
Yes, but that problem is not a, I mean, that's, if you think in that reductionist way, then you need to give some kind of account of when different person slices or, you know, are all parts of the same person. But that's, and so you have to give some kind of account of that. But that's not a problem about the indiscernibility of identicals. It's just a problem in giving, you know, some kind of informative account of personal identity over time. But I think when one's using time relativization to say that somebody was large was small at t0, for example, I don't think that commits one to talking about time slices of people. I don't think that needs to be analyzed as that the, as it were, a funny kind of object, the person at at T0 had the property of being small. I think it's rather that the time relativization is part of the predicate being it's being small at T0, and then that whole predicate is applied just to the person who's not a time slice at all. So, you know, I think one can use time relativization without committing to an ontology, you know, problematic ontology of person slices or stages or whatever. Should we go to the?
Yeah. This is the question. The box. The question. I put out last time. So the question is this: Dear Professor, what do you think of the paradox analysis, especially related to Frege's late worker? Is related to truthfulness and identity of sense and then useless sex.
Yes. Okay. So I'll just briefly explain the paradox of analysis, which is that. I mean, this is a particularly a problem that was raised for philosophers who thought that who wanted to do conceptual analysis, where what they were they were breaking down a concept into its component. And then so for example that if you gave an analysis of knowledge, it would be you would find some complex expression which captured the very same concept as the concept of, and then the worry is that if you actually succeeded in finding a correct analysis, then the result would be trivial because the complex expression would just be the same thing as the original. So it would be kind of just trivial, obvious on the surface that these things were equivalent. So I think I have two main comments about that. One is, I think that actually synonymy, sameness of sense, is not always transparent to competent speakers of the language. A famous example given by Kripke and others of synonymy is in English. There's a kind of shrub, kind of plant, which we have two words, furze and gorse, and these are they're simply synonyms because they're words for exactly the same natural kind, and there's no particular difference between them in the associated descriptions or anything like that. I mean, they probably we have these two words because they originate in different dialects of English or something like that, and then we now have both in the language. And so these are synonyms. They have the same sense. But not everybody knows that they're synonyms, and you could easily be quite reasonably competent with both of these words, and yet not know that they were words of the same natural kind, because this type of shrub, for example, it changes its appearance over the seasons. I mean, in some seasons it's kind of green with yellow flowers, and in other seasons it's sort of brown, and so you might not realize if you one word in one, you know, at one season and the other word at another season, you might not realize it was the same natural kind. But there's no actual difference between them in their meaning in English. So one point about the paradox of analysis is that that sameness of sense doesn't automatically imply triviality. But the other thing I would say is that I don't myself think that that the philosophy should be attempting to do conceptual analysis. I think it's in fact relatively rare that single words of natural language are really synonymous with in the sense of just being completely interchangeable with some complex expression, in a way that's transparent to speakers or even accessible to speakers. And so I think it's often even very difficult to find things that are extensionally equivalent. So, for example, in the case of knowledge, if you're looking for some kind of analysis of knowledge, it seems like none of the ones that people have offered are even work extensionally, or unless they're somehow circular. So I think that conceptual analysis is not really an appropriate aim for philosophers to have. I think it's we can study knowledge itself. We don't need to just focus on the concept of knowledge, and I think generally, if we studying or justice, we don't need to just focus on the concept of justice. We can think about justice itself, and so I don't think that the paradox of analysis should be worrying us, because I think it's aimed at an inappropriate conception of what philosophy should be doing. But I also think that actually the kind of assumptions about the triviality of identifying synonyms are also not, in fact, correct.
Okay. Peter, do you have some question? Peter? Are you here? No question, sorry. Yes, very interesting. Okay. Further question. Then we tonight, maybe we should end up. Next Thursday, Professor Williamson will talk about vagueness. His theory of vagueness called as epistemism. So see all of you at next Thursday night. Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.